Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
January 5th County Commissioners Meeting. At this time, Vice Chairman Boss will do our invocation.
Before we pray, let's have just a moment of silence for the law officers that got shot in New York. I think that that's something we all need to remember every day. When they get up and put those badges on, they go out here and put their life at risk. So let's just have a moment of silence before I pray. Almighty Heavenly Father, thank you so much for what you give us, what you do for us, and God, just thank you for a country that we can live in that is free and is protected by people willing to give their lives every day right here in our country to go out and protect us. Those that go out every day to help us when we're in distress on the side of the road, the EMTs, all of these public servants who put their life at risk for ours. Thank you, God, and just protect them through the year as they go out and do their job, and just be with them, lay your hands on them, and protect them. Be with us today as we go through our meeting and help us to make wise decisions for all of Alamance County and for doing the right things. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Vice Chairman. Yeah, please stand and face the flag for a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have two public speakers that have signed up for today. First one is Mr. Tony Cox.
You know, I know Lash was going to say something good about law enforcement, and I was going to bounce off him this morning, so
you just got started out.
So I guess I got to start. You know, our law enforcement, they are important to us, and sadly, we had to sit there and watch it become political. Man gave his life for the people, and they made it political. Law enforcement has no business being in politics, period. Period, period, period. And there's a lot of people in this country that have gave law enforcement a bad rap, in that enforcers of the law. This sheriff right here, Terry Johnson, I've heard him in this room right here on at least two occasions, maybe more, say, "I can't get my teeth into these ordinances." Terry knows. He's a career lawman, a good man to me. Dan Engel, you're a career lawman.
Yes.
We look for, like you and David Smith, I don't know about career, but he's been a career lawyer. So we look for y'all to make sure, we know the Constitution, we know it, and we know when things are going wrong. And in this country, we've seen that a lot of things have gone wrong. A lot of people have been accused of stuff that they really didn't do. And now, you know, seems like to me back starting around 2000, 2001, it went on a tear in this country. Politicians forgot what it was about, the people. When government helps people, hey, I've had it both ways. When good government helps me, 37 acres out there on Old Stony Mountain Road. I went out there and bought scrap land. The government said, no problem. We'll show you how. Put it in 5 months. And that was during the rainy season. We're over here in Alamance County. And we'll show you. Even go to, Dan, I don't know if you've seen the papers or not, but Deborah Prince was cited for a Class 3 misdemeanor. Everything changes then. You know that. And so, and that brought me down here to start running my mouth, and I've been doing it for years, and I guess I'll continue to do it because I don't see nobody else doing it. I don't know. But law enforcement, we do appreciate y'all. We appreciate all law enforcement that does the job and follows the law. We appreciate people in government that do their job and follow the law. When you go away from the rule of law, though, you change it. And therefore, you got to remember, people, in the long run, it ain't going to help. It's going to make it worse. Y'all have a good day.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. Next, we have Mr. Lance Ridenberry.
Thank you, Tony. Mr. Chairman, first thing I want to mention is I think you need to go back to all meetings at night instead of the daytime. Sun gets in my eyes coming down here. And Chairman Engel, on your New Year's resolutions, you needed to add watermelons in on your garden. You didn't, and plant them earlier this year. Folks, he grows a heck of a watermelon. January 9th, 2015, National Law Enforcement Appreciation Day. I don't know whether to ask you guys, I don't know the proper thing for a proclamation that we honor this day. I'm going to ask Chris Lavender and the newspapers, if they will, to ask the citizens of Alamance County from this day on, the month of January, put a blue bulb in one of your outside lights or just leave a light burning every night for these law enforcement officers. Between Dan, Sheriff Johnson, Chief Deputy Britt, right in this room, we got almost 120 years of law enforcement. That means a lot. They are the most thankless group there is. We don't thank them enough. If you see an officer, I don't care who he is, stop and shake his hand this month. Tell him how much you appreciate him. And don't let it just be for this month. Do it every day. These guys, men and women, put their life in danger every day. And it's two things we as humans are bad about doing. You get sick, you want to pray. Did you pray before? Somebody kicks your door in the house, you want to call a police officer. Did you support that police officer before? Folks, it's time we stand up for our law enforcement. Ask Ms. McCollum out at Green Level, town clerk, what Terry Johnson's people have done for her and that community. I support law enforcement. I'm asking you guys too. I'm asking this nation to pray and let's get our law enforcement safe and recognize them like they should be recognized. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ridenberry. All right, commissioners, any responses?
I've got a question about Lash's question of doing a proclamation. Can we as a county do that and write it up?
If you would like to, we could do it formally at next meeting, or you could make a little motion here if you would like, just and we could figure out a well-worded proclamation and have the chairman sign it. We could do that before the night. That's a consensus.
I would like to make a motion that we do that.
I'll second it.
Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And Mr. Ridenberry has brought a some information that he's received here that I'll make available to the media, members of the media, on National Law Enforcement Appreciation Day, which is January the 9th. And I think, Chris, you've got a copy of it already, I see there. So you may have that, so that would be appropriate. And it's coming
if we
up.
We can get that, Mr. Chairman, and we'll base it off that. I'll be glad to.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Any further comments here for commissioners? All right, we have the consent agenda. Any items in the consent agenda that members would like to see with them? Do I have a motion on the consent agenda?
Make a motion that we approve it as done.
Right. Do I have a second?
I'll second it. Second.
Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Presentations and other business. Approval to apply for a PARTF grant. Brian Baker. Brian, you're up, sir.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
I do have a couple items on the agenda tonight, so I'll thank you in advance for your patience. But the first is, of course, permission to apply for a Parks and Recreation Trust Fund grant. You guys may remember, over the past few years, we've been working to acquire approximately 75 acres adjacent to Cedar Rock Park. That process has been complete, and this grant is an effort to begin development on that property. What you may not know is that at the same time we tried to acquire that property, we've been working to revamp the trail system at Cedar Rock. The trail system there was about 40 years old. It was time for some improvements, and so our staff in-house has completely redone the trail system, including adding 6 miles of horse trail. We've had positive responses to that. I think the public is very happy with those horse trails, and I'm happy to say we've actually been written up in a regional trail riding magazine for our trails, which is great, except for the fact that they're getting a little too popular at this point. The parking lot that we have for our equestrian users is relatively small. It's shared with the historical farm and our more popular disc golf course, and it's at this point not really adequate to handle all the traffic on busy days. So this grant requests funds from the Parks and Recreation Trust Fund to build a parking area and an equestrian trailhead to better suit those needs. It will include a restroom, a parking area, and some camping spots. So the goals we hope to accomplish with these new facilities are, again, as I mentioned, to alleviate the crowded conditions at our current trailhead. Number two is to allow overnight camping for equestrians. We don't have facilities to accommodate that now. Overnight campers need to be close to their horses, to their rigs, and our only campsite is a long way from the parking area now. So this new facility would allow for that. We'd be able to extend the equestrian trail by over a mile and have a venue to host training classes. That's something we've had requested of us by local groups like the 4-H, and this would be able to have regional level training classes for folks on equestrian issues. And the thing I think we're most excited about is that this venue will allow us to host trail rides for the public, for people without horses. As you guys know, having horses is an expensive and time-consuming proposition, so it's just not something that everybody can do, particularly people with young families, and those are the types of folks we want to have out on these trails. So this facility would allow us to offer trail rides to the public for people who don't own horses. It's a little bit difficult at this scale to get an idea of what we're trying to do here, but there's a rough map. You can see our Dean Coleman Road runs along the top of this property into the current entrance of Cedar Rock Park. This facility would actually have a separate entrance off of Friendship Patterson Mill Road, which will help from a traffic standpoint, and apparently the horses are not big fans of our speed bumps that we have going into the park, so that'll alleviate that problem. You'll have the stables, camping areas, restrooms, all right there, dedicated exclusively to the equestrians. So the grant request is for approximately $135,000. The only match from the county we're looking to use would be from the performance management funds. So we're looking to use approximately $100,000 of the funds that were saved by the department in the 2012-13 fiscal year, returned to the department for expenditure on other uses. This is a capital improvement, which is one of the approved uses of those funds. So if you guys have any questions, I'll be happy to field those.
Question?
Does the match not have to be dollar for dollar?
It does. So
another $35,000.
It is. Yeah, we're able to use some of the expenditures that we've already made as a match. Most of those are planning type things. So if you do planning previously, you can use previous planning dollars to match. So that's making up most of the difference. And some of the needed security improvements, like some initial fencing that we had to do on the property when we got it, we're able to use that as a match as well. So the balance is $100,000.
Thank you. How did you come up with that figure, Ryan? $135,000.
Well, I've got our planned budget. It's always a little bit difficult to estimate what it's going to take. But we had an engineer come up with a plan for the parking area and camping areas. He estimated the cost of what it's going to take to construct that. That part is $74,000. We got quotes on the restroom facility, which is $50,000. We're budgeting for that. We got some fencing quotes, so we're budgeting $10,000 in fencing there, and approximately $70,000 for the stable and barn renovation, and then a $23,000 contingency, which is required by the grant. So that's a rough breakdown of the money.
Do you have that information with you now that you can share with the board in terms of the engineer and...
Sure. I don't have the plan for the parking lot, the engineered plans. I can certainly provide that to you guys today.
What is the time frame on this grant?
So we applied for the grant in February, and we wouldn't hear about it until the summer. And by the time all the paperwork gets done, we would be looking to begin construction sometime at the beginning of 2016.
I've got a question. Are there usage fees for the people that are camping overnight? I mean, do they have an input into putting some money back into?
We do. There's a nominal fee. I think it's $10 right now for overnight camping. We would obviously, it's a new facility. There'd be new charges. The horse riding would need to be a charge, so we'd have an opportunity to revisit those.
And how many other parks in North Carolina offer this kind of activity for equestrian?
Some. It's limited. In preparation for our decisions about this grant, we went and visited Tanglewood Park in Forsyth County. They offer this as a service, and that's really the model we're using for doing this. They actually use a third-party operator for their trail rides, which I think is the model we'd like to go towards. They get a relatively modest lease payment from that third party every year, and the third party recoups their expenses from the public. So
what kind of fees are they charging you?
I think it's $30-$35 a person.
So I mean, I would think to go camp in a campground or something overnight, you're looking at $30-$35.
Well, that's for the horse trail rides,
right?
Our camping fees at about $10 are lower than what you're going to see at the state
right.
park system. There's certainly some room there, but we have modest camping facilities, I'll put it that way. So that's the reason for the relatively low fee.
And my thought is, you know, can the public help to put some money back into our county to continue keeping these trails up and
Absolutely.
What we have to do in the future?
Sure.
Yeah. Move approval.
I'll second.
Further discussion?
I just had one other question. On the last bullet point about the rides being open for people that don't own horses. So how does that work? How would I go about doing that?
Sure. Well, the plan would be you'd come down to the park or make a reservation, and you could pay a relatively small fee, $30-$35, and ride on the trails.
So who owns those horses?
Like I said, as a Tanglewood, it's a third party provider.
Okay,
and I think that's what we'd like to do. We don't want to get into the horse ownership
right.
business. It's a possibility if we're not able to find a third party to do it, but that's our plan.
So it sounds like pretty much it's self-sustaining after you make the capital investment using these grant dollars and the savings that you mentioned.
Right. I mean, this is all activities that we're already doing, just at a different place in the park, so there's not going to be a big increase in the amount of personnel or expenditures right. to finish these.
I'm going to say this, I've said it before to Brian, and I think I've mentioned it to this Brian, but I've always been, maybe I'm old-fashioned and old school, I like to see kids out on football fields and basketball courts, and you know, we don't have any soccer fields in Alamance County, and when I say that, I look at, are we spending our money wisely when we're putting the amount of money that we are in these trails? And that doesn't mean that, you know, it's not important. And I understand, you know, everything that was said and what you brought to us. I didn't see a lot in terms of, you know, exactly what your plans are in the information that you brought to the board. I would have liked to have seen that. And because of that, we do have a motion and a second, and certainly we'll vote on it, but I would have liked to have seen more. And I'd also like to know exactly what we are doing in terms of parks and recreation on the recreation side. And I think that's very important because these kids, a lot of them, the only structure that they have in their lives, unfortunately, is what they receive with a coach and a structured team. You know, and I saw in there that, you know, in your presentation, you know, that young people that can't afford horses will have the opportunity to ride. Well, that's a good thing. But with that being said, and you know, also the structure that these young people receive in these athletic events. And I know that we partner with a lot of the municipalities. I understand that. But are we doing what we should be doing as a county? And that's where I'm at right now. But we do have a motion. We have a second. Personally, I'd like to see it tabled and see more information, but we're going to go ahead and vote on that. There's a motion and a second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no? No. Motion carries 4-1. Thank you, Brian.
And we do have a robust athletic program. Sounds like I need to come back and
talk
about
that. I want to hear about that, Brian.
I agree.
I want to hear about it, sir. Thank you.
Great.
All right, moving on. You have also Brian. You're still up. The trails plan.
That's right. Still me. Right. The second thing is that we're here to get approval and adoption of the Alamance County Trail Plan. This is a plan that we put together with the Piedmont Triad Regional Council. Helped us do this recently with funds from the Community Transformation Grant. And this trail plan is really an effort to do. It's the same one. We'll just keep it rolling. I tricked him. Right. So the trail plan is really an effort to do three things, and the number one and most important thing is to help us coordinate what we're doing on our trails with DOT and with the municipalities. We don't have an approved plan for what we're trying to do right now, and inevitably the trails that we're building at some point intersect with roads, intersect with bridges, and if those roads and bridges aren't constructed with pedestrians in mind, it makes it very difficult to try and retrofit pedestrian access onto those things. So this trail plan provides a forecast for where we're looking to go over the next 20 to 30 years. So as in that time frame, as DOT replaces bridges, as they make road improvements, they'll be able to include the type of facilities that will accommodate pedestrian or bike use moving forward. So that's the main reason for this plan. The second reason is that the part of and other granting agencies that we apply to require a master plan. Over the past 7 or 8 years, we've been able to use the Recreation and Parks Master Plan for our trail projects. That master plan is getting dated and doesn't have the level of specificity we need for some of these trails. So this is an effort to meet those requirements to provide a master plan that will satisfy the granting agencies that we seek funding from. And again, the third reason is it just helps us coordinate what we're trying to do. We have a lot of requests from private landowners who are interested in donating their land. We have requests from developers who are hoping to connect their subdivisions with our trail systems, and they want to know what we're going to do in the future. This plan will help us put that out there, coordinate with them. Excited about bringing this to the home builders and letting everyone know, here's where our trails are going to be. If we can work with you in the future on these trails, we'd like to do that. This trail plan doesn't require any immediate action. Again, it's a long-term plan. So the short-term part of this is that we're going to keep working on the Harbor Trail. We've still got a lot of work to do there. Long-term, we've got other trail routes that I'll show you. The pink lines on this map are municipal plan trail routes. The dark purple is the current Harbor Trail, Mountains to Sea Trail route. And the light purple is the new routes that are included in this plan. We made an effort in these trails to connect cultural points of interest, historic points of interest, so that people walking the trails are getting more than just a walk in nature. They're learning more about our county. You can see that we're largely following water bodies, the creeks. That helps us acquire the properties because that's the cheapest land down by the rivers. It gives us an added environmental benefit of preserving those riparian corridors. So these are all coordinated with the municipalities. We met, talked with them in this process and said, where are you guys going to go? We want to be able to connect with those in the future when we get there. So that's a rough outlook. If you guys have any questions about this plan.
Question?
I'd like to make a couple of comments. I thought it was a well-done plan. I was very impressed. And I'm a big believer in planning. Libby knows that. And so I'm in favor of this. And one of my cycling colleagues, who's also a local businessman, happened to be riding his bicycle from Alamance to Hillsboro the other day and came across their some of their bikeways, and, mm-hmm. and so he contacts me, and he says, why can't Alamance County do something like this? So a few days later, I get this, and so it worked out pretty well. We talk about, or you talk about cycling opportunities here, but I don't see it, and of course, this is just a kind of a sketch, but
yeah.
I just want to make sure that we think about bicycles. But I think there's a lot of pedestrian opportunities and hiking, but I'm not sure if there's very much in the way of cycling in this plan. So.
Yeah, two things. These trails, the trails that are laid out here don't, at this point in time, make a decision about what kind of use is going to be allowed there. As we move into the future, it's difficult for us to predict whether, you know, hiking's going to explode or cycling's going to become far more popular, and we'll have to make decisions on what kind of trails these are going to be as we move forward, get past the acquisition stage. The second thing is that we do cooperate with NCDOT on our bike routes, but for the most part, that's an NCDOT trail. So we don't have a ton of input on that. We check the signage just because we like to, but it's a little bit out of our jurisdiction, but it doesn't have to be.
Well, one other comment that I had, if I could, is that I noticed that in the implementation of this plan, there are a couple of commissioner action items later on. So I'm assuming that if we adopt this today, that we're not taking those actions that's being suggested in the plan.
That's right.
That would be a
yeah,
separate.
Yeah, any of those plan. Future items I would bring to you separately if we okay. decide we need to do that.
And Mr. Chair, if I could, one of the things Brian and I talked about was he's got an excellent presentation on the Hall River Trail mm-hmm. that he did at the Chamber Retreat, and we want him to do that as a presentation for the board of the community in the next couple of meetings as well. And that really kind of sets the tone of the Hall River Trail for everything else that we do with respect to trails in Alamance County. So we'll get Brian to do that as well.
Thank you, Mr. Sunkill. Any further comments?
I'd just like to make a comment. I've walked those trails down in Hillsboro. They really are nice. They accommodate walkers, bikers, dogs, mm-hmm. everything, so, which is nice. And I don't know that we will have the funds to do that kind of a expansion without maybe some municipal help, which is what that's around. It's just, I appreciate what you guys have done out there and working with developers and stuff. A lot of, like you said, a lot of that land in that corridor down there next to the river is useless anyhow. I mean,
yeah.
it's floodplain.
Yeah.
So they're not going to build a house. They're not going to be able to use it for anything else. And it is a very positive thing for a developer in looking if he's along those trails to be able to say, you know, we have access to a trail. So yeah. I encourage your communication with developers that are coming into our county, and I think we're going to see a lot more development coming here. So yeah. as we do, I think keep that in mind and work with Libby in planning as they come through with her and see if there's those opportunities that will be available.
For the comments, do I have a motion?
I make a motion.
Mr. Smith, second by the Vice Chair. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Brian.
Thanks.
Appreciate it. All right, Mr. Albright, bid report on the property located at 136 Hall Avenue.
Good morning. Happy New Year.
I'm pleased to report that we, you may recall, we advertised this property for bids at our meeting in first meeting in December. We placed a bid advertisement for the bid in the paper pursuant to the statute 160A-268. We received one sealed bid, which was opened this morning at about 8:15, and Residential Treatment Services of Alamance bid $2,000 for the property. The North Carolina Supreme Court has indicated that the price resulting from an open and competitive bidding procedure can be accepted as market value. And in this case, this agency is providing services to the general public, Residential Treatment Services, and has been for a number of years. I think Mr. Osborne is here. And they intend to maintain the building, provide insurance coverage, replace a lot of windows that need replacing, put a new boiler in, and they can only do that if they own the property. And the county, I think we've owned it since 1972 and haven't done too much to maintain it. So that is the bid that was received this morning, and I present that to the board for its approval or rejection.
Thank you, sir. Do I have a motion on the acceptance of the bid, or any comments?
Well, I'll make the motion to put it on the table to approve the bid.
And I'll second that, and thank you, Ron, for being here with us today.
Good seeing you, Ron. Do I have a motion second? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll prepare a deed and for your signature.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, if I could say, a lot of thanks goes to Clyde and also to Brian as well. This is really the third, is this the third building?
Yes.
Third building that we have gotten rid of that the county has owned, but we've been able to not been able to maintain. So it's good to get these buildings off our books and get them to the private organizations that are providing it and that can put the money into it to invest in into the building. So it really is a win-win for both parties. So, but I do want to appreciate the work Clyde and Brian have done on that.
Thank both of you.
Thank you,
John. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Honeycutt. Item number five, under seven, resolution designating alternate voting delegate. Did I miss one? I'm sorry. The health department. Stacy said that'd be okay. It's on if you come on. We'll follow the agenda. Thank you. And I apologize for jumping over item number three.
It's all right. So recently, the first Happy New Year. Thank you for letting me present today. Recently, the Board of Health recognized our retirees and our partners for their contributions to public health. And in addition, we also recognized two employees for their public service. And I've been asked to let you all know about those two employees. So we do have two awards. One is the You Can Count on Me Award, and the other is the Employee of the Year Award. First, I'd like to recognize Kathleen Darty as the 2014 You Can Count on Me recipient. She wasn't able to join us today, but that award is given to an individual that contributes to the mission and the goals of the health department and in public health in general and can be counted on to do the job. And so congratulations to her. And the Employee of the Year Award is given to an individual who exemplifies the performance and dedication to duty and service and has made significant contributions to the Alamance County Health Department and in public health in general. They're known to be effective, responsive, and respected in public health. So I would like to take just a second to recognize Ms. Carla Hampton, who is with us today. And I'm going to make this kind of quick, because I know Carla doesn't want to stand up the whole time. Carla has been a dedicated Alamance County employee and a health department employee for more than 20 years. She has witnessed the ever-changing landscape of public health firsthand. And she has stayed tried and true to this county and to our health department, and is a true, her longevity is a true testament to her commitment to public health. Carla spends her days caring for a multitude of clients who enter the doors of the clinic at the health department. She provides consistent and thorough care to each of her clients. She also presents a calm demeanor and remains even calm in circumstances where clients are upset or unhappy with their outcomes, which is often. She is often the first to arrive in the clinic. She begins her day far earlier than most. She is often seen early in the morning preparing for the work of the day and checking the rooms and supplies. She does this not because she's told to or is because of her or part of her duties, just because that she can and she wants to. She serves as a preceptor to the future public health practitioners. So it's important to us at the health department that we raise up the next generation of public health providers. And Carla does that each day at the health department. But moreover than that, Carla cares for those with whom she works. She has a generous nature and shows incredible thoughtfulness when her coworkers are having hard times. She also shares in the jubilation with coworkers during good times and has become a rock of stability. She's seen a lot of us change through the years, and in my 7 years there, she's seen me come from a grant-funded position to the health director and gone through a couple of babies with me as well. Carla is a quiet soldier. She goes unnoticed most of her day because she does her job so well and so efficient. She is dependable, reliable, and steady. She is strong in her skills and in her character. And because of that, she makes all of us better. So please join me in recognizing and thanking Ms. Carla Hampton for her more than 20 years of service and being the Employee of the Year for 2014.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Anson, for a job well done. Would you like to say a word or two?
No.
Thank you. We appreciate it. Thank you again. All right. Now, I think we're back at aisle number five.
Number five.
Thank you. Resolution designating alternate voting delegate. This will be at the NOCON Association of County Commissioners. Ms. Massey will continue to be the delegate. She does plan to attend, but this is just in the event Linda, that you have to have surgery. So we want to be prepared, and that's all that is to do. With that in mind, any comments or questions? I'll make the motion that we approve Dan Engel to be the alternate.
I'll second that. Approve Dan Engel to be the alternate.
Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. All right. Moving to our next item. Commissioners' comments. Comments from commissioners. Who'd like to start?
You're going to catch Craig first.
Craig?
That's
all right.
Damn,
come on over there.
Don't matter.
Hey, who was that said maybe we need to move to ask the meeting? I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do want to announce that today is sort of the end of an era. Congressman Walker's office and Janine Osborne, they will be leaving the confines of the county office building and moving over to the Cobb Ezekiel building as of today. So I don't know how many years Congressman Coble had his office here, but it was a wonderful partnership that we had with the office. But we understand they're moving for space and a larger suite than what we can provide. But I did want to publicly mention that. So if you need congressional services, probably beginning tomorrow over at the Cobb Ezekiel building where the congressman's new offices will be. If there's any questions on that. Couple of dates to remember. This week we do have the SOAR breakfast. Our employee recognition breakfast is Wednesday at 8:30 at the Family Justice Center. So I'd like to invite everybody to attend that if you would like. Also, next week is the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners Legislative Conference in Pinehurst, January 15th and 16th. I think everybody who's going has contacted Tori and everything started with that. And also wanted to mention two meetings that we have on January 20th. The first one will be at 8:30 a.m. with the Board of the school board, over on Vaughn Road in the professional library. Again, that'll begin at 8:30. The superintendent and I are working on an agenda. It's going to be very open. You know, it's not going to be that structured. It's really just more of a conversation about process and things moving forward. So,
what day is it?
That is on Tuesday, January 20th. At 8:30 a.m. on Ball Road. And also, since Martin Luther King's Day is the 19th, which is that Monday, which is our next scheduled meeting, we will be also meeting on the 20th that evening at 7 p.m. And that is all I have at this moment. Happy New Year.
On what?
We have to be away from unsick people.
We're going to meet on Wednesday?
Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Trying to keep you guys straight.
You're doing a good job. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sonny.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Now, County Commissioners, comments. Who'd like to start?
I will. Number one, I'm excited about this new year. It's been a pleasure already working with this board, and I look for us to do a lot of good things this year. There is one thing I would like to see us as a board look at once again, and I see Mr. Mayor of Gibsonville, Mr. Lenny Williams, out there, and it makes me think of the Guilford-Alamance County line. I think we still have something unresolved there that hopefully this year we can revisit and talk to the Guilford County Commissioners and figure out where we're going to go with that. I know there's a lot left undone on that, so.
Well, I looked at the newspapers, and they don't want to do anything with it.
Well.
But I thought.
Mr. Chairman, if you would like, the motion, and Judge Smith, if I get this wrong, please let me know. The motion from the past board was to table it until after the election. And because there could have been a change on their board as well.
Right.
If you would like, we will be glad to send a letter to their new chair on behalf of Chairman Engel and saying, hey, is there any interest in moving forward, that there's interest with this board to resolve this issue finally. We can be glad to do that if you would like.
Invite the chair to lunch with our chair.
We will do that as well. Yeah. Yes, sir.
We can do that and sit down and talk about that and any other issues that they might want to discuss.
Yeah.
And that'd be a good way to approach
sir.
That. Thank you. Thank you,
yes,
Mr. Sunke. Any other comments from commissioners?
Well, I'd like to echo Eddie. I'm looking forward to this new year too. And I agree. I think that the line needs to be looked at, but very important to me is to undertake this strategic planning process. So I'm looking forward to that.
And we will be having a presentation at our 20th meeting on some initial steps.
Great.
So we're working on that.
Sounds good. Anything else, Ms. Burke?
I can't think of anything.
Lou, do you have anything?
I'm going to be another great-grandmother.
Well, I'm going to be a granddaddy again, so this keeps moving on. And, congratulations.
Thank you.
Judge, you got anything?
No.
I'll comment similar to our vice chair and Mr. Byrd. It is an exciting time. I'm excited about this entire board. I think we've got an outstanding board going forward, and it's at a good time in this county. When you see a lot of things that are very positive, it's a good time to be a county commissioner. It really is, and I'm excited about that, and I think Alamance County, I think it's going to be a great place. It is a great place to live, and it's going to be better. And we've got good staff. Thank you, staff, for the job you do. Got great reporters covering our meetings. And thank you. And I'm excited. And with that, if there's nothing further, meeting is adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the Commissioners' meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.